school. Our first song this morning is the B-I-B-L-E. We're going to sing it twice.
Thank you.
one birthday this week, we'd like to sing to Leanna. Looking forward to our time together. Let's suppose that you're driving down this road. And what do you do when you get to the point where you have to decide whether to go to the right or to the left? It's the fork in the road. What do? Well, the path of life is sometimes like this. We have to choose whether we're going to be on God's path or on Satan's path. Some people think that they don't have to choose. They can just ride along in the middle, not really choosing one side or the other. But we know that's not true. We know that if we don't choose to obey God, we'll automatically end up on Satan's side. Today we're going to talk about two different kings who made two different choices. Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you so much for our lesson time here, and we pray that as we study about Nebuchadnezzar and Belshazzar and the choices that they made, that you will help us to decide that we want to love and obey you always. Amen. How many of you have heard of a meerkat? From the sound of the name, it sounds like it must be some kind of cat. But actually, a meerkat is a type of a mongoose. Well, what is a mongoose? A mongoose is a small animal that weighs about a pound and a half, measures about a foot long, including their tail. And mongooses, in general, are known for their bold attacks on highly venomous snakes, such as king cobras. Well, like I said, a meerkat is one type of a mongoose, and meerkats, like prairie dogs, they live in underground burrows, and they live in family groups of 20 to 30 meerkats. They mainly eat other insects and animals like lizards, snakes, scorpions, and a variety of other small animals. They live in the Kalahari Desert in southern Africa. Now, in the desert, there is not very many trees, so they don't have a lot of protection from potential predators. And meerkats spend a lot of their time looking for food to eat, so they might not notice when a predator was approaching. So it sounds like it's quite dangerous to be a meerkat. Are you wondering how they stay safe? Yeah, me too. Well, what they do is they have one meerkat who carefully watches for danger while the rest look for food. If it sees a hawk or other potential predator coming near, it makes an alarm sound so that all the meerkats know they should quickly run to a safe place. That's something like what God's prophets do. God often gives prophets warning messages so that people can know what they should do to be safe and avoid Satan's traps. Daniel warned Nebuchadnezzar to stop being proud, and that's what we're going to talk about today. We've talked about Nebuchadnezzar for a few weeks now. Nebuchadnezzar had made Babylon a beautiful, magnificent city. And he was the most powerful king in the world at this time. He started conquering other nations, including Judah, and he was a great builder. Babylon was the strongest, most beautiful city in the world, and all that made him feel very proud. Now, we talked a couple weeks ago about how Nebuchadnezzar was humbled when Daniel told him the meaning of his dream of the image and told him about what that meant. And Nebuchadnezzar acknowledged that truly Daniel's God was the God of gods and Lord of lords. But time went by, and again Nebuchadnezzar became proud when he built this amazing statue of gold, which we studied about last week. Again, Nebuchadnezzar was humbled when Daniel's friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, were saved in the fiery furnace. But as time passed, again, Nebuchadnezzar slips back into feeling proud of what he's accomplished and what he's built. Let's remind ourselves what Daniel had said to Nebuchadnezzar about what made him so great. Grace is going to read for us Daniel 2:37.
Your Majesty, you are the King of Kings. The God of Heaven has given you dominion and power and might and glory. Daniel 2:37.
Thank you, Grace. So in spite of the fact that Nebuchadnezzar knew his greatness came from God, he continued to go back and forth between God's side and Satan's side. Satan was tempting him to choose to be on his side, and God was trying to help him choose to do the right so he could be saved. God loved Nebuchadnezzar, and he gave the king another dream to warn him of danger. Chloe is going to read for us Daniel 4, verses 4 through 6.
A little over 7 years ago, while I, Nebuchadnezzar, was resting in the palace, I thought about everything I had done for Babylon, and it was feeling quite proud of myself. Then I fell asleep and had a dream, which frightened me. The more I thought about this dream, the more I felt sure that it had some evil messages for me. So I called all the royal men in Babylon to come to the palace to help me understand my dream.
Thank you, Chloe. So Nebuchadnezzar's had another dream, and he's again calling his wise men. Let's see how that goes.
Had another dream. Go get the wise men.
Yes, Your Majesty. The king has had another dream.
Dream, and in it there was a tall tree that reached to the heavens, and it was cut down, and only the stump was left. What's the interpretation?
We have no idea.
Oh, out with you!
So once again, the wise men could not interpret Nebuchadnezzar's dream. They let him down. So Daniel was called in, whose other name, his Babylonian name, was Belteshazzar.
Oh, Belteshazzar, because I know the spirit of the holy gods is in you, and no secret troubles you, tell me my dreams and dreams.
What did you dream?
Okay, I'll tell you.
So Nebuchadnezzar told Daniel what he dreamed.
These were the visions of my head while on my bed. I was looking, and behold, a tree in the midst of the earth, and its height was great. The tree grew and became strong. Its height reached to the heavens, and it could be seen to the ends of all the earth. Its leaves were lovely, its fruit abundant, and in it was food for all. The beasts of the field found shade under it. The birds of the heavens dwelt in its branches, and all flesh was fed from it. I saw in the visions of my head while on my bed, and there was a watcher, a holy one, coming down from heaven. He cried aloud and said thus, "Chop down the tree and cut off its branches, strip off its leaves and scatter its fruit. Let the beasts get out from under it, and the birds from its branches. Nevertheless, leave the stump and roots in the earth, bound with a band of iron and bronze, in the tender grass of the field. Let it be wet with the dew of heaven, and let him graze with the beasts on the grass of the earth. Let his heart be changed from that of a man. Let him be given the heart of a beast, and let seven times pass over him. This decision is by the decree of the watchers, and the sentence by the word of the holy ones, in order that the living may know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men, gives it to whomever he will, and sets over it the lowest of men."
So this tree in Nebuchadnezzar's dream sounds amazing, reaching up to the heavens, providing homes for birds, beautiful fruit for everyone, shade for the animals, and beautiful leaves on the tree. But then a holy watcher gives this order to cut down the tree with only the stump and the roots remaining. Well, all this would happen that the living may know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men. Daniel finished hearing the whole dream, and he was speechless. It tells us in Prophets and Kings that Daniel found the meaning of the dream to be plain, and its significance startled him. Let's go and see what the king said to Daniel.
O Belteshazzar, let not the interpretation trouble you.
My lord, let the dream be to them that hate you, and the interpretation to your enemies. The tree you saw, which grew and was strong, whose height reached under the heaven, visible to the whole earth. It is you, O king, that has grown and become strong, for your greatness is grown and reaches unto heaven, your dominion to the end of the earth. O king, this is the decree of the Most High, that they shall drive you from men, and you shall eat grass as oxen, living with the beasts of the field.
So just as the stump was saved, God would let Nebuchadnezzar be king again after he had become humble. Let's see what advice Daniel gives the king after sharing the interpretation with the king.
O king, let my counsel be acceptable unto thee. Turn from your sins and show mercy to the poor. Perhaps there may be lengthening of your prosperity.
So Daniel gave King Nebuchadnezzar some advice after the dream, like we heard. As the months passed, King Nebuchadnezzar went back to his same old proud ways. He rejected the warning and began to treat his people unfairly. He became sure that his kingdom was so powerful because of him. A whole year slipped by, and one day, while walking on one of his rooftop palaces, he scanned the city before him. As he breathed in the Babylonian air, a thought struck him with great force. Everywhere he looked, he saw reminders of his power and clever leadership. The hanging gardens, walls, temples, and palaces were impressive. In every direction, he saw the greatness of a world empire and city that was renowned. He basked in these thoughts.
Look at this great Babylon I have built.
Right away, God took away Nebuchadnezzar's mind. Let's read Daniel 4, verses 31 and 32. It says, while the word was still in the king's mouth, a voice fell from heaven. King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is spoken, the kingdom has departed from you. And they shall drive you from men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. They shall make you eat grass like oxen, and seven times shall pass over you, until you know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men and gives it to whomever he chooses. So Nebuchadnezzar was taken to live as a beast in the field.
That very hour, the word was fulfilled concerning Nebuchadnezzar. He was driven from men and ate grass like oxen. His body was wet with the dew of heaven, till his hair had grown like eagle's wings and his nails like bird's claws.
At the end of 7 years, God gave Nebuchadnezzar's reason back. Whom did he praise? Let's see.
Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and honor the King of Heaven, all whose words are truth and his ways justice, and those who walk in pride he is able to put down.
Ellen White tells us in Prophets and Kings that the once proud monarch had become a humble child of God. Satan probably thought that he had Nebuchadnezzar on his side. But the proud king became humble and gave his heart to God. God was glad to forgive Nebuchadnezzar his sins when he repented and let God change him. Did God love King Nebuchadnezzar? Yes, definitely. The second king we're going to talk about today is King Belshazzar, the grandson of King Nebuchadnezzar. A Belshazzar is not to be confused with Daniel's Babylonian name, Belteshazzar. This is King Belshazzar. And he, even though he knew the stories about his grandfather and how his grandfather had been humbled, he still chose not to obey and trust God. Instead, he worshiped idols and he lifted his heart up against God, choosing not to love, obey, and trust the true God. Well, one night he decided to have a big party and he invited 1,000 people to this party. There were the wise men that were there, learned, educated men, there were women there, there were statesmen and princes and all kinds of people that he invited to this huge party. And this was in the setting of enemies, which were camped outside of the city of Babylon. Well, who were these enemies? Well, it was the Medes and Persians under the leadership of Cyrus, who was the nephew of Darius the Mede. Anyway, it would seem like this would not be a time to have a big party when your city is being threatened by enemy armies. But Belshazzar felt confident that they could not get in, and the city was surrounded by two strong walls, and it had a river running through it with strong iron gates, and he felt like they had enough food and went on living life. And he was gonna have this big party, this big wicked party. Well, let's see what was going on at this party. Let's read Daniel chapter 5, verse 4, and see what it was like. It says, they drank wine and praised the gods of gold and silver, bronze and iron, wood and stone. Let's see what this party might have looked a little bit like.
Oh, what a good party this is. Thank you everyone for coming.
Where they were drinking wine like water, when the party kind of reached the height of revelry that was going on, all of a sudden everything just stopped. The music stopped. The celebrating, the dancing just stopped. And Belshazzar was terrified. All of a sudden he saw something being written on the wall with a human hand. What did he see though? Why was he so terrified? He was paralyzed with fear in the presence of the unseen watcher, and his knees began to knot together. Let's read Daniel 5, verse 5. It says, in the same hour, the fingers of a man's hand appeared and wrote opposite the lampstand on the plaster of the wall of the king's palace, and the king saw the part of the hand that wrote.
Thank you. tried to read the burning letters on the wall, but he could not. In despair, he turned to his wise men.
If you can tell me what the words on the wall mean, you will receive rewards.
I don't know what the words on the wall mean.
Remembered Daniel, who over a half a century before had made known to King Nebuchadnezzar the dream of the great image and its interpretation. So Daniel was called, and the king promised him rewards if he could interpret the writing. Just like he promised the wise men, he said he would be clothed in scarlet, he would get a gold chain around his neck, and he would be made third ruler in the kingdom. Daniel said, "That's okay. I don't need your rewards." But Daniel did tell Belshazzar reminded Belshazzar about what Nebuchadnezzar had happened to him and how Nebuchadnezzar had been humbled. And then he said in Daniel 5, 22 and 23, he said, "But you, his son, Belshazzar, have not humbled your heart, although you knew all this. And you have lifted yourself up against the Lord of heaven. They have brought the vessels of his house before you, and you and your lords, your wives and your concubines, have drunk wine from them. And you have praised the gods of silver and gold, bronze and iron, wood and stone, which do not see or hear or know. And the God who holds your breath in his hand and owns all your ways, you have not glorified." Then Daniel proceeded to tell him the meaning of the words on the wall.
"And this is the inscription that was written, Meeni, meeni, tekel, upharsin. This is the interpretation of the word of each word. Meeni, God has numbered your kingdom and finished it. Tekel, you have been weighed in the balances and found wanting. Upharsin, your kingdom has been divided and given to the Medes and the Persians.
The city has been taken."
The end of the Babylonian Empire and all its greatness came that very night. The Medo-Persians, who were camped outside the city, they found a way to get through those strong walls, and they actually came in and took the city that night. And Belshazzar lost his life that very evening. It was too late for Belshazzar. God had looked at his life and seen that he had ignored all the opportunities God had given him to repent. He was still holding on to sin in his life, so he was found to be wanting. I have a balance here, and as long as I have things that are about equal weight, it should stay pretty evenly balanced. But if I add this rock representing sin to one side, things quickly become out of balance. And when we have sin in our life, things are out of balance and we can be found to be wanting. Now, this is not about the number of sins that you put on one side and balancing out with the number of good deeds and kind things you do for other people. That's not the way this illustration works here at all. It's just to illustrate that if we're holding on to sin, we can be found wanting. But if we repent and ask God for forgiveness for our sins, and we do our best to love and obey Him, then we won't be found wanting. And we won't be making the same mistake that Belshazzar made and have the same end. Let's read our memory verse together. It's Romans 14:10 through 12. It says, "We shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Each of us shall give account of himself to God." Nebuchadnezzar sinned and he was proud, but he repented and he let God change his heart. So he ended up on God's side. When he stands before Christ's judgment seat, his name will stay in God's book of life. He'll be able to enter heaven. But Belshazzar, on the other hand, he made a different choice. He was proud. He didn't repent. And he will not be able to enter heaven. Today, we can choose. We can choose to repent and let God change us so that when we stand before Christ's judgment seat, God can remove our sins and our names will stay in God's book of life. I know that's what each of you wants today. Let's bow our heads. Dear God, we thank you for these stories about King Nebuchadnezzar and Belshazzar. We thank you that you are ready and willing to forgive our sins so that we can be ready to be with you forever. Thank you for being here with us today. Thank you for loving us so very